Welcome to this video about flip-flop kinetics. In most cases, the absorption rate Ka is larger than the elimination rate K, with the elimination rate being equal to the clearance divided by the volume. But in some cases, the absorption rate is actually smaller than the elimination rate, and that's what we call flip-flop kinetics. It can, for instance, occur if we have an extended release formulation, or in case of subcutaneous or intramuscular administration, or also, for instance, for class 3 or 4 drugs with a slow absorption or poor water solubility. And this phenomenon of flip-flop kinetics deserves special attention because it can lead to incorrect estimated PK parameters that will perturb the interpretation of the results. To understand this, let's consider a one-compartment model with first-order absorption and linear elimination. In this case, there are actually two sets of parameters that lead to exactly the same concentration time curve. Let me show you this with MLExplore. In this MLExplore script, I have set up a very simple KAVK model using the PK model macro. That's the initial values for the parameters, and I will administer a single dose at time 0 with the following amount and record the drug concentration CC between time 0 and time 20. If I check the prediction, that's what I see. I first click Add Reference to freeze my current prediction, and now let's see what happens if I change the parameter values. So I'm going to change Ka to 0.2, K to 4. I can see how the prediction changes. And if I set V to 0.4, I actually have exactly the same prediction as before, the two predictions with the two different sets of parameters being on top of each other. To understand how this is possible, let's have a look at the analytical solution. This is the analytical solution for one compartment model. D is the dose absorbed in the systemic circulation. It can be smaller than the dose administered depending on the bioavailability. V is the volume of the central compartment, Ka the absorption rate, K the elimination rate, and T the time after the dose. I will now duplicate this equation and start to reorganize it. I will first swap these two terms and these two terms. When I swap terms, I have a minus sign coming out. As I have swapped twice, the two minus signs cancel each other. Next, I multiply the numerator and the denominator by k. And I will now group those three parameters together and define the following transformation. Ka prime is equals to k, k prime is equals to Ka, and V prime is equals to this group that we have here. So if I'm introducing those transformations, I'll get this equation here, and we can see that it's exactly the same as above, except that the values of K and Ka are swapped, and the value for V, V prime, is changed. So these are the two sets of parameters that correspond to one or the other parameterization, and they give exactly the same prediction in terms of concentration over time. So now, which set of parameter is the correct one? If you have only extravascular data, you will need to rely on your prior knowledge to decide. Even if we move to a population PK model, where in addition to the structural model, we also have a statistical model, the two model parameterizations are indistinguishable. In these two monolix runs, for instance, I have simulated data using the same parameters I have shown before and an inter-individual variability of 20% for all parameters. So that's the data. I have chosen a KAVK model, and in this run, I have chosen initial parameters with a Ka value smaller than the K, while in this run, have inverted the two Ka and K values. We can see in the results, in the population parameters that indeed two different solutions are found. But if we check in the plots, the individual fits look as good in both cases, same for the ops versus spread, and same for any plot actually, also the VPC. If I'm checking the results in terms of likelihood, I can see that these two runs, although they correspond to two different solutions, have exactly the same log likelihood. So we cannot decide which solution is the correct one. To know if you have a regular kinetics or a flip-flop kinetics, extravascular PK data after an extravascular administration alone cannot tell. You need to rely on other information. In addition, note that the auto-init button that we have here for PK models may give you the flip-flop or the non-flip-flop solution, and it is your responsibility to check if it is the one you want to use. So it is important to properly set the initial values using your prior knowledge in order to get the correct final estimates for correct interpretation. And as a side note, I have here used the parameterization with elimination rates, but everything would work the same with clearances. So that was an example with subcutaneous data only. Things get easier if we also have intravenous data. So let me show you an example where we have both subcutaneous and intravenous data. In this example, I have loaded a dataset with some individuals which have received an IV bolus and some a subcutaneous administration. The two types of doses are distinguished with the column administration ID. Let's have a look at the data in the data viewer. If I check the data on log scale, and in the Stratify tab allocate the root covariate in order to color, I can pretty clearly see that the terminal slope is different for the subcutaneous and for the IV root. So that's the first hint that we may be in a case where we have a flip-flop kinetic, meaning an absorption rate slower than the elimination rate. Let's go back to monolics. As a structural model, I have loaded a model that handles both intravenous and extravascular doses. Note that I have a parameter F, the absolute bioavailability, that we can estimate because we have both IV and subcutaneous in this case. For the initial values, if I go to log scale, I have set initial values that give a pretty good initial match. Note that these initial values rather correspond to the regular solution where Ka is larger than K. This project has already run, so we can directly go to the plots. Here we see the individual fits, and they look very nice both for the IV and the subcutaneous doses. If I check the ops versus spread, it looks pretty good too. However, if I check the distribution of the individual parameters, I see that it's good for all parameters except for the elimination rate K, where I can see actually a B-model distribution for the empirical values in blue. If I check the parameters versus covariates, we can actually see that these two different sets of values correspond to the IV and subcutaneous route. If I go to the results, I can see the same for the individual parameters directly. Here, for the IV route, the elimination rate is around 3 to 4, but when I move down to the subcutaneous individuals, the value is much smaller. If I check the estimated population parameters, what also strikes me is the very small value for the absolute bioavailability. That is much smaller than what I was expecting for this molecule and this route of administration. Let's check on the slides what is exactly happening with this run. I have written here the analytical solution for the IV individuals and for the subcutaneous individuals. They share the same volume of distribution V and the same elimination rate K. Also note that we have the absolute bioavailability here. In the previous example, I had shown you how to swap Ka and K and redefine the volume. But here, if we redefine the volume here, it will also affect the IV solution that would not fit the data anymore. So in fact, because the volume value is also driven by the IV data, the redefinition will not be on V, but on F, because F only appears in the subcutaneous solution. So if I do the transformation, that's what I obtain. In this parameterization, I have an unphysiologically small value for F, a narrow log-normal distribution for the volume and for Ka prime. However, for the elimination rate, I'm going to have two different values, one for IV and one for the subcutaneous route. The population parameters that MonoX has found in the run actually correspond to this parameterization here. But actually, the parameterization I would like to find is this one here, where I have a consistent elimination rate for both routes of administration. And MonoX has found the wrong solution, because actually I have used inappropriate initial values. In this second run now, I have the same dataset, same model, but for the initial estimates, I have been more careful and I have chosen a Ka initial value that is smaller than the K parameter. If I look at the diagnostic plots, I still have very good individual fits for both IV and subcutaneous. Same for ops versus spread, but this time the distribution of the individual parameters is consistent for all parameters, and the value estimated for the absolute bioavailability is closer to what I was expecting. So this is the solution I was looking for. I have also loaded the two runs in Sycamore to easily compare the likelihood, and actually I see that the Bayesian information criteria is significantly lower for the second run compared to the first run. Let's go back to Monolix. To better understand the behavior of the model with this parameter set, I suggest to export it to MLExplore. So I will first go to initial estimates, apply the use last estimate, and now export to MLExplore. I'm gonna save and export. And here actually I will choose the first individual and the last one to have one individual with IV and one with subcutaneous administration. It has created automatically a simulation script that I can directly run. And here I see the IV simulation is orange and the subcutaneous simulation in blue. Let's try to understand the impact of the parameters. So I will freeze what I have on the screen with the add reference and then try to change the value of Ka. And actually when I change the value of Ka, I see that I don't have an impact here during the absorption, but much more an impact here during the last phase. So when the absorption rate Ka is smaller than the elimination rate K, it is important to remember that the final slope is not driven by the elimination, but rather by the absorption rate, because the absorption is a rate-limiting process. Actually, this has also an impact for a non-compartmental analysis, so let me show you what happens in PeakAnalytics. In this PeakAnalytics project, I have loaded the same dataset as before, with both IV and subcutaneous individuals. In the task, I have set the administration type, intravenous and extravascular, and if I run the non-compartmental analysis, we're gonna see the results for each individual, as we have here in a big table. But actually, let me show you directly the plots. If I'm going into individuals versus covariates, that's what we get for the half-life. And we see that the half-life is pretty different between IV and subcutaneous, because for IV individuals, the terminal half-life represents the elimination process, while for the subcutaneous individual, it is related to the absorption. So the take-home message is, be careful about your initial values. If you have only extravascular data, it is not possible to decipher from the PK data only if the kinetic is regular with Ka larger or flip-flop with Ka smaller than the elimination rate K. On the opposite, if you have both extravascular and intravascular data, then the correct solution, regular or flip-flop, can be deciphered based on the diagnostic plots and the likelihood. The hints for flip-flop kinetics are the following. If you plot the data, you will generally see different final slopes for intravenous and extravascular. In an NCA analysis, you may see different half-life for also intravascular and extravascular. And finally, if you have a route with a slow absorption, such as intramuscular or oral with extended release formulation, you are also pretty likely to have a flip-flop kinetics. That's it for today. Have a nice week.